Good morning and welcome. Sorry, I don't need to wear this while I'm actually speaking to people. Good morning and welcome to our first live service from St Mary's. It's actually only partially live. You'll see in this service an awful lot of it is just going to come by video. And there is no congregation here apart from the vicarage sat down here at the front and Ian wonderfully all the way at the back operating tech. Thank you guys for coming in. We thought it would be helpful to have a test run without a congregation, but our hope is that next week this building will be full, albeit in a socially distanced way, and the service will come to you like that. I'll say more about that later on. But we're going to begin our time together with some words from the book of Revelation. They'll come up on the screen, and if you would like to join in, whether you're here in church or watching from home, if you could join in the words in bold, this will just remind us of the God in whose name we are gathering today. So Revelation chapter 4 says, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you have created all things, and by your will they have their being. You are worthy, O Lamb, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed for God saints from every tribe and language and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests serving our God, and they will reign with you on earth. To the one who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor, glory and might forever and ever. Amen." Well, if you're at home, we're going to sing together now, O Lord my God, a great hymn of praise to the God that we have just spoken of. If you're here in church, we can't sing, but we will watch and listen to the song anyway.
I
So we've just sung of the God who made us and the God who went to the cross in our place for our forgiveness and the one who will return to take us home. But knowing that our Creator is one who gave his life for our forgiveness, it's great that we can come and confess our sins together, knowing that if we are trusting Jesus, we are absolutely assured of his forgiveness. So let's take just a moment of quiet to allow the Holy Spirit to bring to mind things that we might need to confess to God, and then we will join in praying a confession together. Jesus says, "Repent. For the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. We pray together, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the collect for today. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, and to give more than either we desire or deserve. Pour down upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things which we are not worthy to ask, but through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to come to God's word now. Hedy is going to read, and after that, Debs is going to preach. Both the reading and the sermon are pre-recorded, although our hope is that in future weeks, at least some of that will come live from the lectern behind me. If we had a real live congregation here today, someone would have pointed out that I haven't yet done up my collar and put my dog collar on. So I'll do that while Hedy's reading.
Good morning, everyone. The reading today is Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God, O King, and I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. I will meditate on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works. Men shall speak of the might of your awesome acts, and I will declare your greatness. They shall utter the memory of your great goodness and shall sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power to make known to the sons of man his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord upholds all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look expectantly to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways, gracious in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. He will fulfill the desire of those who fear him. He also will hear their cry and save them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh shall bless his holy name forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning. Today we're going to be spending some time in Psalm 145, thinking about praising God. But before we dive into that psalm, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever wondered if animals could talk, what they would say? Ever wondered what the squirrels are saying to each other when they're chattering about in the trees? Or what the pigeons are arguing over in the garden? What about dogs? What would dogs say if they could talk? In the last year, both of my sisters have adopted dogs. This is Maggie. She's an Australian cattle dog cross and she's about 4 months old. Maggie is still young enough to be excited about absolutely everything, so it's pretty easy to guess what she would say if she could talk. One of the things she absolutely loves is going for walks. When my sister Rachel gets the lead and the poo bags out of the cupboard, Maggie goes nuts. She abandons whatever she's doing at the time. She jumps up and down, barking, really excited about going outside. It's almost like she's saying, "Walkies, walkies, I love walkies. Can we go now? Thank you so much for taking me out. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Can we go? Can we go? Can we go?" Maggie responds to something she loves with eagerness and joy. In today's psalm, Psalm 145, David has seen something he loves. David has seen God. Psalm 145 is packed full of different things that David knows and has experienced about God over his lifetime, interspersed with David's response to what he sees about God, which is praise. David sees something he loves and responds with joyful and eager praise. Now, I don't know about you, but when I first read that psalm, there was a little part of me that was a little bit intimidated. Because, I don't know about you, but I don't always find praising God that easy. I have had the odd experience where I've read something about God and just welled over with praise, or where I've been walking in his creation and been so delighted by the sun and the birds and the trees and everything going on around me that I found myself wanting to jump up and down in a manner very similar to that of Maggie Dog. But I've also had days where praising God is really hard. There are days when I feel more like my other sister's dog, Maisie. Maisie is a 9-year-old Dalmatian. Maisie also loves walks. However, Maisie is not always very happy about going on a walk. There have been times when my sister has practically had to drag her out of the front door to get her going on the walk. If she could talk, I imagine she'd be saying something like this. Oh, do I have to? But I'm older than Maggie. Walking's hard. I don't feel very well. But I love my bed and my rests, and I don't want to leave my snuggly place by the fire. But I've been to loads of parks before, and it's just that not that exciting. Do I have to go out? Do you find that when it comes to praising God, you also have some buts? But I don't really know how to praise God. But my attention is focused on other things right now that seem more real than God, like work or family or daily chores or even having fun. But I'm just not feeling like praise. I'm poorly, I'm having a bad day, or someone I love is suffering. But actually, I have doubts about the God that I'm meant to be praising. My world has been turned upside down and I'm just not sure anymore. But I just don't want to praise God right now. Praising God is often hard. But here we have a psalm where David is overflowing with eager and joyful praise. David isn't a guy who had a super easy life or who always found praising God easy, as we can see from the stories of his life in 1 and 2 Samuel. So what enabled David to praise God in this way? And what can help us to praise God like David did? Well, the answer from the psalm is simple. God. The key to David's praise wasn't that he tried hard or wasn't that he was super praiseful, but that he saw God. He truly knew and experienced God in his life through God's words and through God's works. And he couldn't help himself. He responded in praise, wherever, whatever, and forever. So we're going to spend some time together now looking at what David saw about God and how he responded in praise to help us praise God wherever we are, whatever we face, and focused on forever. So let's look at Psalm 145 and start by looking at the God David praised. The God David praised is incredible, isn't he? I mean, look at how many different things David picked out in this psalm to describe God. And he hasn't even scratched the surface. God's greatness in verse 3, God's mighty works in verse 4, God's splendour in verse 5, God's goodness in verse 6, his graciousness and love in verse 8, his kindness, his kingship, his eternal nature in verse 13. The list goes on and on. And I'd love to be able to spend time looking at each one of these things in detail. But sadly, if we did that, we'd still be here next Sunday. So instead, I'm just going to focus on verses 3 to 5 and verses 13 to 16 and look at just two of the things that David saw about God. That he's a wondrous worker and a generous giver. So we can begin to get a glimpse of the God David knew and praise him. So let me reread verse 3 to 5. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendour of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. David knew God as a wondrous worker. David knew God as an active God, not a God who sits on his throne unaware or uninvolved in the lives of his creation, but a God with his sleeves rolled up, wonderfully working on behalf of his people. David knew this from the history of God's people. For example, God's mighty acts in creating the world in Genesis 1, or rescuing his people from slavery in Egypt in Exodus 9-12. And David also knew God at work in his personal and individual life, protecting him from murder plots, installing him as king, and providing for his needs. And let's look for a minute at the God who rolled up his sleeves, at the God who did those works, who reached down and got involved in the nitty-gritty of human lives. Great is the Lord, greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. To be great is to be superior, better than normal, set apart. But God's greatness is so great that it's unsearchable. That means God is so great that we can actually never fully understand how great he is, because he's actually too great for our minds to comprehend. David considers more of God in verse 5 as he meditates on the glorious splendour of your majesty. What a great phrase. David knows God not just as great, but as a great majestic king. A king over the entire universe who is so splendid, so breathtaking in character, so glorious and perfect, that he is unlike any other king that has ever sat on a throne in all eternity. And think about it. It's this God that got involved in time and history to the work for the good of his people. And today, we've actually seen God's wondrous work in a way that David hoped for, but never actually saw. Because we have seen Jesus. Jesus, God's Son. Jesus, called Emmanuel, God himself with us. Jesus, who came to live in our broken world with us. Jesus, who died an agonizing, horrific, and lonely death on a cross for us, to destroy the very thing that should alienate us from knowing this God in the first place, our sin. The Bible says that every one of the people God made rejected him and lived their lives as if he didn't exist. Because of that sin, we deserve to be unable to see or know the great God of the whole universe. We deserve to be utterly rejected by him, just as we have done to him. But Jesus died in our place, defeating our sin through his love, meaning that for all who trust on him, we can see God, we can know God, and we can know God's love for us. Verse 18 of our Psalm 145 says this: "The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth." In John 14 verse 6, Jesus says about himself, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Because of what Jesus has done, we have the promise that this God is near to all those who come to him, trusting in Jesus' rescue on the cross. This God. God's wondrous work through Jesus has brought God near to us and created a way for us to see him, know him, and praise him in the first place. How cool is that? And that was just one aspect of God that David praises him for. The second thing I want to pick out is God as the generous giver in verse 13 to 15. Let me read those verses. "The Lord is faithful in all his works and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you and you give them food in due season." David also knew God as a generous giver. David was human, and like all humans, he had needs. He faced hunger. He faced restlessness. He was sad and afraid. He faced days that he didn't think he'd see the end of. And in those times, David prayed to God, calling on him for help. And he experienced God's nearness to all who call on him in verse 18. He experienced God's hearing cry and saved him in verse 19. He experienced God's generosity. In verse 13 to 16, we see David praising God for upholding him, strengthening him, raising him up in times of struggle. David isn't necessarily praising God here for ending his times of struggle, but for upholding him through them, for taking the weight of his struggles and strengthening him to keep going through them. When I was 13 or 14 or so, I took part in the Duke of Edinburgh Bronze Award. Now, that award was a cacophony of disaster. But as part of that award, one of the things that happened was we had to go for a long walk, and that involved carrying all of the things you needed with you in a rucksack on your back. Now, I wasn't particularly used to going on really long walks, so I wasn't particularly prepared, and I didn't have particularly all the right gear. And because of some slightly inappropriate footwear and an unexpected rabbit hole, I fell and I twisted my ankle. But we were miles away from the finishing point, and I was really struggling to keep going. I wanted to complete my Duke of Edinburgh Award and to get the end, but my ankle was really painful and I was really struggling to keep going. The rest of the group I was walking with stopped to help me. They took my rucksack off, they took all of the things, all of the weight from my rucksack and distributed it amongst themselves. They let me put my arms around their shoulders and they helped me to walk, literally lifting the weight from my poorly foot and allowing me to get to the end. They took my burden to help me get to the end of the Duke of Edinburgh Award. In verse 13 to 15, we see that David knew God taking his burdens through the trials of his life and raising him up. He knew God providing for him in his daily needs. He experienced God's generosity, and it gave him the strength to keep going, to keep trusting God through the hard times of his life. So here, David praises God, the generous giver. And again, how much more do we know the generosity of God through Jesus? How much more do we know the promise to be raised up when we are bowed down, not just in our problems today, but for all eternity? We've seen the wondrous work of God in raising Jesus from the dead, and the promise to all who believe in him that we will be raised too, that we will be raised to live into all eternity with God, never to be bowed down again. Revelation 21 verse 3 says this: "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more." That is the picture of the future that we will be raised into. David knew God as a generous giver. How much more do we know that too, this side of the cross? As I've said, there's so much more to say about God from this psalm. And do spend time enjoying God in your own time by reading this psalm. Because the God David knew and praised is the God we know and we can know too. If you're watching this and you wouldn't call yourself a Christian, let me tell you that this God that David knew, it's the God that the Bible says we can know and we can have a relationship with, we can be near and spend eternity with if we believe in Jesus. And if you'd like to find more, about that, please do get in touch, because we'd love to tell you more about the God we praise. And Christians, the God David knew is the God through Jesus that we can know as well. God hasn't changed. In fact, because of Jesus, we can know even more of God and his plans, his love, his promises and his perfections. So let's get to know him. Let's spend time in our Bibles, seeking God on each of its pages. Let's dedicate time to prayer, that we might seek God's nearness and lift our needs to him. Let's look for God in his world and in his works, and keep experiencing him by trusting and living for him in his world. David didn't praise God because he was super special or tried hard. But he saw God and he responded in praise. And we can know and see the same God too. So we've spent time looking at the God David praised, and now we're moving on to look at the way David praised in response to God. And the way he did that was by praising God wherever, whatever, and forever. David praised God wherever he was, whatever he faced, and focused on forever. So let's look at each of those three things in turn. David praised God wherever he was. Look back down at Psalm 145. Have you noticed how many different ways David praised God? He praised God on his own, verse 1 and 2, and with other people, verse 10, which says, "All your works shall give thanks to you." He praised God by speaking, both to God in verse 2, to others in the church in verse 4, which says, "One generation will commend your works to another," and to the world in verse 11, which says, "We will tell of your power and make known to the children of man your mighty deeds." David praised God by doing evangelism. He praised God by meditation in verse 5, by taking time out to sit and reflect on the God that he'd seen. He praised God by singing in verse 7, by asking him for what he needed in verse 15 and 16, by calling on him in verse 18, by trusting him with his salvation in verse 19. David's praise of God fills his entire life. David's response to God isn't limited to saying thank you to God at the end of the day. But David praises God wherever he is by living his whole life in response to what he has seen and knows of God. One of the reasons we might find it hard to praise God today is that we don't know how to praise God. But David shows us here that we can praise God wherever we are, simply by making the choices and decisions of life in response to what we see and know of God, both big and small. We can praise God wherever we are. Another reason we often find it hard to praise God is because we're distracted by other things that might seem more real than God in that moment. You know, the problems that are pressing into our minds, the chores that need to be done, the child that is crying downstairs, maybe even the fun things that we're looking forward to. Because these things seem more real than God, more pressing or more present or more full of pleasure, they can distract our thoughts, our feelings and our time from God and actually lead us to see less of him and instead more of the Hoover that needs emptying. But what if, rather than letting these things draw us away from God, we used these things to draw us closer to God and use these things to help us to praise God wherever we are? For example, if our minds are filled with stresses at work, why don't we let those stresses remind us of the God who has given us the gifts to work? Remind us of the God who cares and wants to hear about the jobs we need to do and the problems we face. Or say, our minds are filled with the coronavirus pandemic and the loneliness of lockdown. What if we used that to look at the God who is near to us through Jesus? To see the God who doesn't socially distance from us and who is constantly working for the good of those who love him? When it's hard to praise God because of distractions, let's use those distractions to see God and praise him wherever we are. So David praised God wherever he was, and David praised God whatever he faced. We've already mentioned that David's life was full of different trials and suffering. In Psalm 22, verse 1 to 2, David says to God, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest." David knew times of real trouble. And he knew times where praising God was really hard, just like we do. The times I find hardest to praise God are the times when I'm facing troubles or feeling miserable. When I'm ill or loved ones are hurting or I'm hurting and I can't make it stop. In those times, I don't feel like praising God. I feel like crying. Sometimes we might even question whether what we know about God and his love and his goodness are even true at all. So did David. But David shows us it is possible to praise God through tears. In the next line of Psalm 22, verse 3, David reminds himself who God is. He says, "Yet you, God, are holy. You are enthroned on the praises of Israel." Whatever he faced, David praised God by looking for God. And through seeking God, he experienced God with him and was able to praise God in verse 14 of our psalm for being a God who upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. Who God is and what he has done doesn't change when we are suffering. And continuing to look for him and continuing to see the God who is near and the God who knows what we're going through, who cried those very words from Psalm 22 as he died on the cross, can give us that glimmer of joy and that hope of praise, even through the darkness and the suffering. So David praised God wherever, whatever, and he praised God focused on forever. Finally today, did you notice how many times the words forever and ever appear in this psalm? The whole psalm is bookended by it. Verse 1 says, "I will bless your name forever and ever." And verse 21 says, "Let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever." David is praising God with forever in focus. This is a psalm of praise, both to God now, but also looking forward to forever, when we will be praising God eagerly and joyfully as he deserves in eternity. This psalm looks forward to forever, where the God we see now in part, we will see completely and understand his love, patience, grace and mercy like never before. What we know and can see of God now is like a single raindrop compared to the ocean of God that we will see and know in eternity. And the praise we feel and give now will be nothing compared to the consuming joy we'll feel when we praise God in eternity. So when we're frustrated because we can't see God now as we'd like, or we don't feel like we're praising him as he deserves, or when praising God is hard now, when even seeing God feels impossible, when we're praising through the tears and the pain, we can cling on to this, that because of what Jesus has done, we have forever. When we will see our God, when we will know eager and incomparable joy at being with him in heaven, and when we will praise him as he deserves. And in those times, even that thought can lead us to praise him today. Psalm 145 is a psalm of praise. Throughout his life, David had seen and experienced God and responded in praise, praising God wherever he was, whatever he faced, and focused on forever. Our God has not changed. This is our God. So let's seek to see him now and respond in praise, wherever, whatever, and forever. Let me pray to close. Father God, thank you so much that we can know you, that we can see you, that you have revealed yourself to us. Thank you so much that you deserve our praise, that you are so amazing, so great, that you deserve our praises. Lord, we ask for your help to praise you wherever we are, whatever we face, and focused on forever, especially when it's hard to do so. And we ask for your help to look forward to the time in eternity where we will see you as you truly are, know you as you are, and will praise you forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Debs, very much indeed for bringing God's word to us. Well, it's obviously appropriate that we respond to a passage like that by praising God. Verse 8 of Psalm 145 says this: "The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love." We're going to sing, well, you're going to sing at home, we're going to listen here in church to a song based on that verse.
As far as the east is from the west, that's how far
Catherine, thank you very much for leading us in that. In a few moments, we're going to turn to prayer, but before we do, we're going to declare our faith together in one of the forms of the Creed. Again, if you would join in the words in bold. So thinking of the God who Debs has spoken to us about, the God that Debs has reminded us of, do you believe and trust in God the Father, the source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope you have found it easy enough to access this at home, and that watching this live is being as helpful for you as it is for me here. I've got to say I'm loving being here with some other people and look forward to that even more. You'll see... I don't know how much you can see on the camera, actually, but the church is set up for really quite safe social distancing. And the reason there are these two chairs here is that will give a place for someone who's doing a reading and someone who's leading prayers, perhaps, to sit without taking up a whole load of room in the congregation. So if you feel safe, we would love you to join us next week. We do have to limit spaces, and that means we need to ask you to sign up in advance, and you can do that on our website, www.smwp.co.uk. If you follow the kind of pop-up about coronavirus, it will take you to a page where there is a link that you can sign up. We would love you to be able to join us. We're also here this evening for a short service of evening prayer that probably won't be live streamed, but it would be a chance for us to gather and pray together. If you'd like to come, there are still a few spaces left, but again, you need to sign up. But the equipment that we've needed to make it possible to do this sort of live stream has had it come at a cost, and Becca is now going to say a little bit about that, and then I'll lead us in prayer.
Hi everyone, it's nice to see you this morning. Welcome to my living room. Hi everyone, it's nice to see you this morning. Welcome to my living room.
We seem to be having some slight technical difficulties. If we can't get that quickly, I'll just put it on social media later.
Hi everyone. It's nice to see you this morning. Welcome to my living room.
Keep going, we can hear it even if we can't see her move. Oh well, not to worry. You for, as Debs has so helpfully reminded us. But Father, we also have much that we need to ask you for. We live in difficult times in a difficult world at the moment. And we firstly want to continue to pray for your provision, Lord, for an end of the coronavirus pandemic. And we pray, Lord, for a vaccine. We ask for you to bless all those who are working on producing it. Lord, please bring this towards a close, we pray. And we pray particularly with schools going back this week and with universities going back shortly after that. Lord, we pray that there would not be a second wave, and that you would protect us from some of the awful things that are being seen in other parts of the world, even other parts of Europe. And Lord, we do pray especially for schools going back next week. We pray, Lord, for the teachers who are working incredibly hard, especially with guidance that seems to vary from moment to moment. Lord, would you bless them in their work? Would you sustain them? Would you carry them through it? We pray particularly for two teachers who are members of the St. Mary's family. Pray for Chris and for Sarah. Lord, please would you bless them and look after them in all of this. We pray also for all the children going back. We ask that you would keep them safe. And we ask, Lord, that they would have a really fruitful year of good education ahead of them, being able to enjoy interacting with one another, and for them life being slightly more normal. Please do protect them, we pray. And please protect the families of these children as they adjust to doing the school run again, perhaps, and with all the other things that will come with it. So, Lord, we pray for your help and your mercy. Lord, we also pray for us as a church family, and we pray for our mission going forward. Lord, we do continue to ask that your glorious gospel will be heard and believed in our parish. And we pray that you would help us as a church to be faithful witnesses to you. Would you give us more and more opportunities to communicate your love to the people who live nearby and to our colleagues and friends and families and neighbours and so on. And Lord, I pray especially that in the month of September, which lies ahead, you would stir us as a church up to greater prayerfulness. Please, Lord, would you teach us to pray afresh? And would we be faithful in praying for one another and our parish and mission and for our world? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, if the equipment behaves again, we're going to hand over to Kate and Ali now for the kids' slot as they bring what we've been thinking about as adults in a way that's hopefully accessible to younger people as well.
Hello, children.
Hello.
Today we're going to think about praising God. That means saying wow to God. Have you ever said to God, "Wow, you are awesome"? What things might make us want to say, "Wow, God"? For me, it's sometimes when I learn about the amazing things that God has made, like when I watch something on the telly about the beautiful creatures under the sea, or when I learn how many stars there are in the whole universe. That makes me want to say, "Wow, God, you're so powerful and you're so clever and beautiful." Or it might be when I think about Jesus coming down from heaven to live with us and die for us on the cross. And I think, "Wow, God, your love is amazing. And you give yourself and you're so kind and merciful." I wonder what things make you say, "Wow, God." The Bible tells us loads of reasons to say, "Wow, God." Wonderful things that God has done and wonderful things about who he is. I'm going to read to you some words from the Bible about how amazing God is. This is Psalm 145, verses 8 and 9. "The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made." The Bible says that God is patient and kind and good to us, even when we're not good, because he loves everyone he has made. Are your parents always kind to you when you're naughty or annoying? Or do they get grumpy sometimes?
Ali! That's annoying. Stop it. Oh, Ali, what are you... Oh, Ali! Oscar! No, stop it. Stop it. Ali, stop it. You're being really annoying. Seriously, that's enough.
It's hard for us human beings to be patient and forgiving like God. We get things wrong every day.
But God is much more wonderful than us. If we follow Jesus, God is our Father in heaven who always forgives us. We can come to him knowing he won't be cross with us, but he loves to hear what we want to say. That makes me say, wow, God, you are so kind and loving and patient. There are so many wonderful things about God. We will never run out of wows to say to him. We can say wow to God every time we notice something amazing about him. And we can say wow to God every day, because God doesn't change. Whether we're having a good day or a bad day, he's still amazing. Now we're going to start our prayer time today by playing a game that you can try at home later. It's called the Wow God throwing game. So Ali and I are going to play a game where every time we catch the cushion, we have to say wow God about something. While you're at home, you can watch us and you can pray along with us and say wow to God about those things. And then later, after church, you could play this game at home too. Are you ready?
Yeah. Dear God, I want to say wow about this space. He made everything. Amen.
God, I want to say wow about the oceans and all the beautiful creatures that are down there. Amen.
Dear God, I want to say wow about just high-tech gadgets. Amen.
Amen. God, I want to say wow that you're so full of love that you sent Jesus to rescue us.
Dear God, I want to say wow that you died for us. Pretty much the same as Kate's, but I think it's so amazing. I think I just want to say it too.
Yeah. And I want to say wow that you have come to live inside us by your Holy Spirit.
I think that's all I've got.
That's fine. We'll play again later. So you can have a go at that game at home later, but now we're going to pray together. Can you get into your comfy prayer positions? We're going to say the Lord's Prayer together that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Now we're going to learn a new song called God of Wow, and it's all about saying wow to God for how amazing he is.
More I learn about you, exclamation. just say, wow, amazing, how could this be? And I say, well, you're more than I could ever, ever dream. You're the God of wow, amazing, how could this be? You're the God of wow, you're more than I could ever, ever dream. The more I learn about you, exclamation points about to the God of wow. Designer of the dinosaurs, mapper of the ocean floor, of all the wilds in low above, the best of all is your great love, you're the God of wow.
Thanks, Catherine. I found it really hard not to sing along to that, but we have to remember not to if we're in church. I hope you enjoyed it at home. Well, it's time that we bring this service to a close and that we jump on Zoom, anyone that would like to now. That will be set up in just a moment. But let me again say thank you so much for coming along, in the case of the Vicarage and Ian, and thank you for tuning in elsewhere. And we would love to have some of you with us next week. Do just sign up on our website. That would be great. But let me close with a final prayer, asking God's blessing on us all. May God the Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen you to walk with him in his risen life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Thanks for joining us. God bless. See some of you shortly on Zoom. Otherwise, see you next week. Bye-bye.